It's a great pleasure for me, and I'm Anne-Marie Mai, one of the chairs of the D-IAS, to introduce to you my dear colleague, Professor Klaus Petersen, who's a historian, and he's also a director of the Danish Center for Welfare Studies. This is a very interesting and very well-qualified research environment, attracting a lot of young researchers, and it has been very important to the whole of SDU for the last 15 years, I think. Klaus has received several research grants from Danish Research Council, from private foundations, and also from Nordic foundations. Along with Klaus, I co-managed the SDU 2020 project, a NICE, Narrative Indicators, Concepts, Welfare Europe. And Klaus and I are also working together on the uses of literature along with several colleagues here. It has always been such a great fun and challenge to me to cooperate. So I am happy to share the experience of Klaus's scholarship with you today. He's published in numerous leading journals and very important articles and also monographs. He has co-edited the six volumes of Danish welfare history from the 18th century to the present, along with two other researchers. And this is a very important work to Danish and Nordic welfare research. He has a very broad network of international welfare studies, and very soon is also going to publish a new monograph, War and Welfare, Mass Welfare and European Welfare States. And this monograph will appear at Oxford University Press this year. Today his topic is tracing the global history of the concept of the welfare states, and please welcome Klaus.
So thank you, Anne-Marie, for the kind words, and also thanks for the invitation. I hope I'll not ruin the fun part afterwards, but yeah, it's up to me now. So, words matters. I mean, this is to some degree a no-brainer. We all know from our writing and reading that this is the case. But mostly we don't really reflect upon it. So we don't reflect about the meaning of words or why we are taking by words. And that's what I partly will address today. So I'll talk about words, or rather a specific concept, the welfare state. So what I would like to do is to outline the historical career of the term welfare state from the mid-19th century until today in a comparative and a transnational perspective. I mean, then the first question is, of course, is this at all important, or is this just like the nerdy interest of some weird historian? The latter is most certainly the case. But I think it's also important because it's a way of addressing the general history of the welfare state. It offers some new insights in what you could say is probably one of the most important characteristics of 20th century history, namely the development of the welfare state. So luckily, I'm not alone thinking that words matters within the discipline of history. Conceptual history has over the last two or three decades been one of the most liveliest research sub-disciplines. And also within, you would say, my broader subfield of political history, the whole movement towards what is called a new political history is based on the argument that communication, language, words matters also if we want to understand the dynamics of power. And even within social science, this has been, a kind of turn in the same direction. So we can look at the role of ideas literature, where one of the most prominent representatives, my Canadian colleague and co-author Daniel Berlin, has labeled concept as what he called discursive weapons. We can also point to other trends within social sciences, George Lakoff's work on metaphors and the use of metaphors, the framing theory, and a whole lot of different approaches that all signals that word matters. And then finally, if we turn to the more, say, present-day politics, analyze of politics tends to also to point in the same direction. So we don't have to be like a very active observer of present-day politics to be aware that spin is really important, so knowing the concept spin, which is basically an argument that playing with words is a pretty efficient political strategy. I mean, just to mention one example is Norman Fairclough's study of New Labour, New Language from the 2000s, give an example. Or we could take the radicalized version of spin, the debate about fake news, where you again find an obsession with words. So I guess most of you remember Trump's semantic innovation with the word graffiti as an example. So, but Trump aside, back to the welfare state. So one of the reasons why the welfare state is a tricky concept is that it is at the same time an analytical concept and a political concept. So this makes it a little bit complicated to analyze. Or in the words of my British colleague Dan Wincott, trying to survey the discussions about the concept in the academic literature, arguing that while the expressions, this is a quote, while the expressions of the welfare state has many interpretations and connotations, both academic and popular, there's surprisingly few clear discussions of the concept. The field does need to be mapped. So what I'm trying here to do is to kind of contribute to this mapping exercise to a large degree. It also does not take a lot of effort to figure out that the political use of the concept welfare state is what you could say is pluralistic in many ways. So all Danish politicians love the welfare state, but it's also quite clear that they want to do quite different things at the same time. So theoretically, you can argue we're maybe not caught between a rock and a hard place, but we're caught between Max Weber and Humpty Dumpty. So this is a quote from Weber in his famous book, Science as a Vocation, where he's arguing for concepts being an analytical tool. So it's the logischen Schraubstock you can use to figure out if an argument is right or wrong. On the other hand, we have Humpty Dumpty's more pragmatic approach. I guess you all know Humpty Dumpty from Lewis Carroll's wonderful children's book, so at least from the popular Disney version of Alice in Wonderland, arguing in an extremely pragmatic way that words can mean everything, that it depends on who masters the word, what the meaning is. So my strategy has to be turn this into a puzzle and asking, so rather than searching for, say, the true meaning of the concept welfare state, I'm interested in understanding how the welfare state has been used, by whom, and for which purposes. So the actual use of the term welfare state. And I believe this is also an important contribution to Max Weber's argument for analytical clarity. So this can contribute to that. But I think at the end of the day, I must confess I'm probably more Humpty Dumpty than Max Weber in this respect. But we can get back to that discussion afterwards. So the background of this project dates long back in history, until in 2001, when I wrote a short article on the political use of the concept welfare state in Denmark. And this made me curious, start thinking about what is the international background, where does this concept actually come from? And as a first step, I start to dig into the academic literature. But what I found was a lot of suggestions, a mess of suggestions, loose observations, postulates, often being presented as facts. So I came to remember what an elderly colleague told me many years back, said it's good if you can show that your argument is right, it's twice as good if you can also show that somebody else is wrong. So I thought this might be, in many ways, the perfect research project. However, the whole thing became somewhat sidetracked, so the seven volume is actually seven volumes, Danish welfare state history that Anna-Marie mentioned, and also co-directing a large Nordic Center of Excellence kind of sidetracked that, and meant I had to to take a break. But from 2014, I've started working on this. And also say this is not my main research project. So it's been a pet project I've been working on alongside other things. But it's kind of a nice, nerdy project, and luckily it still feels fun to do. So the overall project, as you can see here, involves several case studies. So this is my, you could say, overall research plan. A couple of pieces have been published, but there's still quite a lot of work to do. So that's nice. I still hope to have some years left at the university. So in most cases, I have collected lots of data and also drafted some of the arguments. And right now, I'm in the process of writing a number of articles based on these case studies. And then my hope is to collect the whole thing in a book-length manuscript, because I think it's actually a quite interesting contribution to comparative welfare state research. So overall, my main research questions are fairly simple. So when and where did the term origin? How was welfare state used and by whom? And then finally, what did it actually mean? So with meaning, I mean the content and the connotations of the concept. And my research strategy is also fairly simple and straightforward. It's simply collecting and analyzing text that is using the term welfare state. Partly using systematic searches in larger databases like Google Books, ProQuest, on the American database for newspapers and similar stuff, but also at the same time using a snowball method, so following one reference to another and see exactly where it leads. And I think maybe also at this point I should add a disclaimer. So what I'm studying is the concept welfare state. I'm not studying the concept of word welfare or the concept of the word state. I mean, both have a pretty long history that would take me elsewhere. I'm studying the combined concept, so welfare state. I should also add that my argument, just to make sure, my argument is not that studying one concept can explain everything. So I will not find the full explanation for the development of welfare state with this approach. I mean, in order to do that, you have to call in the usual suspects of socioeconomic structures, political actors, institutions, and so what have you. But my argument is that, I mean, including this perspective in the analysis is adding something new and will contribute to a better understanding of welfare state development. So today, and time is flying already, it's of course not possible for me to go into all the nitty-gritty empirical details of my finding. That would take a full week, and I guess you would be all gone when we go there. So I'll not present the full story here today, but I mean, rather than drowning you in details, I would present some, say, highlights or selected aspects, tasting menu. Of my research, and I hopefully that would be enough to at least give you an impression of my argument. So the agenda for today is that first I will tell you discuss the origins of the concept welfare state, where did it come from and what did it actually mean. Second, I'll jump to the US in the 1940s and 50s. I mean, this is, I think, one of the most interesting cases, at least for me. And third, I'll go back to post-war Denmark, the highly celebrated Danish welfare state. And then fourth, we will end up in Burma in the 1940s and 50s. So it's quite different context, but actually it's playing some of the same mechanisms. And then finally, of course, I'll try to wrap it up, and I'll also present a couple of ideas for, say, developing this story. So, the French historian Marc Bloch famously criticized historians for being obsessed with origins. Bloch warned that the factors that define or explain the origin of something is not necessarily the same things that explain why this phenomena keeps on developing or keeps on existing. And I think Bloch's warning is really well taken also if we want to dig into the history of the welfare state, starting the history of the concept welfare state. But still, there is something, let's say, fascinating with the studying the origin of something, especially, I think, if you are a historian, there's a certain thrill to it, discovering the origins. So let's take a quick look how far back in history we can actually trace our concept. So as already mentioned, my starting point was the existing literature. And looking at this there was a number of suggestions pointing in quite different directions. So some books or articles pointed toward Germany in the late 19th century, typically pointing towards the political economist Adam Wagner and the Verein für Sozialpolitik, the influential, you could say, agenda-setting arena for discussing social policy in Germany in the 19th century, or to von Papen's attack on the Weimar Wohlfahrtsstaat in the early 1930s. Other researchers pointed to interwar Britain, to Britain in the 1930s and 40s, to British intellectuals such as Alfred Simon, Ernst Baker, or as the most dominant trend to Archbishop William Temple and his best-selling book from 1941 on Citizen and Churchman, where he presented the warfare state and the welfare state as some of his key concepts. But looking at this, it quite soon became clear to us that the origin was German. But still, sorting out, you could say, the details and digging back in history was actually, pretty much hard work. Luckily, I could do it in close cooperation with my colleague, Jan Henrik Petersen, so we could share the experience of emailing at late night, presenting our newest finding, with bringing it a couple of years further back in time. So, for instance, discovering that the German legal scholar Rudolf von Kneist did not use the concept in his first edition of his book on German state tradition, but only in the third edition published 8 years later. So sometimes small things make you very happy. But we basically had to engage with a pretty impressive lineup of leading German intellectuals from the late 19th century and early 20th century. So the aforementioned von Kneist, who was considered to say a founding father of the German legal history tradition. Lorenz von Stein, who is, to say, a founding father of public administration. We have Adolf Wagner, a founding father of political economy. And we also had prominent sociologists like Max Weber and Ferdinand Tönnies. So it was a pretty nice lineup, and we were in really good company, and it was actually quite interesting and fun. But the end of the day, what we found was there was actually no real pattern. So basically, you could say this is our first really solid finding. If you look at the origins, it's hard to find any pattern that is important. So I'll spare you for all the details. I mean, this would take quite a while. If some of you are interested, Jan Henrik and I published an article in Journal of European Social Policy in 2014, where you'll find this in more detail. But just some, the main results. So to sort out the origins, the oldest example of the use welfare state we found in the German context was a young German academic, a young Hegelian, Karl Naumerk, who defined the welfare state in a surprisingly modern way. So the welfare state is the commitment of the of society on the individual and the other way around. So this is a way, defining the welfare state as the functions of the state. So it's a pretty modern definition in many ways. And this is the oldest one we found from 1844. Then of course you can start reflecting, if he's using the term in this way, that might actually signal that it was already used by somebody else. So I guess in the future we might be able to push it even further back. But I guess that's the condition, is if you're looking for the origin of something, it would be a never-ending story. But what we found when going from Karl Naumerk in 1844 and onwards were others and quite different uses of the term welfare state or Wohlfahrtsstaat, you know, in the German context. So first, there are some people defining the welfare state as a type of state, often comparing it to the Rechtsstaat or even the police state as different types of state, so it's state typology. Whereas others, as Naumerk, tended to define the welfare state more with reference to the functions of the state, so the more closer to the modern day understanding of the welfare state. And secondly, we found also that the uses were both positive and negative. So overall, again, the pattern is that there is no pattern. It was a little bit all over the place. And it's maybe not so surprising if you're looking for the origins, if you start thinking about it, because the origins of concept will also be the period where it's not well-defined, there's no tradition, so it's kind of open for grasp and for different interpretations. And it was only when the term entered, you say, the broader political debate, that it became more fixed in the meaning as kind of the functions of the state, the modern understanding of the welfare state. And I would also argue that actually still today in the debate, you might find this broad description of the welfare state as a type of state as a reference. So some people use the welfare state as a description of the overall societal architecture of Denmark, for instance. But in most cases, welfare state is now kind of relating to social policy. And this happened in the post-war era, coming closer to our present-day understanding. However, this did not happen in Germany, but happened in the Anglo-Saxon context. The concept welfare state and related terms were used in Britain since the 1920s, but became much more popular, or had a more genuine breakthrough only in the 1940s. This happened in several countries, and actually not only English-speaking countries. The background, I think, was two factors. So one of them was the experience of the war. So generally, the war led to the growth of the state in almost all countries. At the same time, or in parallel, you could say, that it also relates to specific promises made during the war. So we can point to the Atlantic Charter from 1941, presented by Roosevelt and Churchill, where they promised the freedom from fear and want after the war. We can find the same thing in national post-war planning, such as the Beveridge Plan from 1942-43, which actually was also used as active in the war. So the Brits made summaries of the Beveridge Plan and dropped it from airplanes all over Germany to kind of weaken, or you could say, to weaken the spirit of the German population. And we find the same thing if we look at the post-war programs of the political party, especially the social democratic ones. And altogether, this was creating, you could say, high hopes for the future. The New Jerusalem, it was labeled in the British debate. And it demonstrates that words can be political weapons. And this brings us back to the term, the concept welfare state. So, as already mentioned, Bishop William Temple published in 1941 his book Citizen and Churchman, where he contrasted the warfare state, that's the evil German state, and the welfare state, which was the positive democratic society, on the other hand. And this book became an immediate bestseller and contributed to the popularization of the concept, also in broader political use. So even though it was not Temple's intention, the term quite quickly became a synonym for the big state, including social security and social reforms. So these more complex, diverging meanings of the concept that we found in the longer German history kind of disappeared, or was at least marginalized in the post-war debate. However, this breakthrough of the concept did not necessarily lead to the popularization of the concept. Actually, if we look at the concept welfare state, it suffers from a really bad press, especially during the early Cold War. This was not least the case in the US. So, I'll just leave this for a second. So, in the US, the term welfare state has been used in the 1930s and 40s on few occasions, but typically referring to developments or ideas from Europe. But clearly, if you look at the figures, this changes significantly in the late 1940s. So this is data collected from the ProQuest newspaper database. It's a full-text database of US historical newspapers. There's also a couple of British, but we can leave them aside here. Which clearly shows that something happens with the concept in the late 1940s, early 1950s. There was a breakthrough. But of course, this does not explain what actually happened. But here, studying the history of the concept welfare state opens for a deeper understanding of the links between the Cold War and welfare state development. when we talk about war and welfare states development, one of the important mechanisms is that war creates the need for loyalty, and social policy is often used as an instrument to achieve this loyalty. So you can think about different types of pensions for soldiers, you can think about caring for the families of soldiers during wartime, or making promises for social intervention after the war, so the GI Bill in the US would be a prime example of this. This is stuff we discuss much more in the book. Anne-Marie mentioned that it's coming out in July on war and welfare, so that's much more detailed. But based on this, one expectation for the Cold War could actually be that the proponents of social reforms could use and would use the Cold War context as an argument for social reforms. This was, to a large degree, what happened in Europe, and as I'll show you, also partly in Burma. But in the US, things worked quite differently. So the experience in the US from the 1930s with the New Deal, the war leading to an enormous growth in the American state, as demonstrated by James Sparrow in his recent book on the welfare state, could in many ways have paved the way for welfare state development in the US. In the first years after 1945, after the end of the war, there were voices arguing in the U.S. that the U.S. should follow, you say, the North European path in developing social security. This is well described in Jonathan Bell's book from 2011, Liberalism on Trial. But then, as Churchill introduced his Iron Curtain across dividing Europe in his famous Fulton speech from 1947, and the Cold War took off for real, the doors for reform closed. And my argument is that the debate about the term welfare state was a key used to close the door. So the popularity in this in the table of the concept was not driven by, you could say, a desire for social reforms. It was rather driven by a crusade, a full-scale mobilization against state regulation, taxes, and social reforms. So the concept welfare state framed all these things in one concept and became, you could say, the target of attacks. So according to one contemporary observer, the leading US trade unionist George Meany, reactionary punted around for a new phrase, and this phrase was the welfare state. And the argument from the critics in the US case was fairly simple. So first, the welfare state was collectivism, collectivism was socialism, and socialism was at least halfway to communism. Secondly, the Cold War was a struggle or battle between US values and communism, so the famous battle for the hearts and minds of people, both globally and in the US. And then, consequently, the welfare state was to be considered as something un-American and a threat to American society. So in other words, you say the critics of state regulation, higher taxes, social spending, used the Cold War context and the concept instrumentally to push back what you say could be labeled as a progressive reform agenda. The semantics or the campaign against the semantic crusade against the welfare state took various forms in the US case. So there was an intellectual campaign where the focus typically was on the conflict or between welfare state collectivism and individual freedom. I mean, one of the main proponents of voices in this line of critique was the former US President Herbert Hoover. There was a partly overlapping campaign orchestrated by business interests, such as the Chambers of Commerce and other interest groups. And then finally, there was a very strongly negative discourse in American media. So my most explicit example is from the LA Times, who in 1951 asked the readers to come up with nicknames for the welfare state. And they were semantically innovative readers, so they came up with the Santa Claus state, the handout state, the everything for nothing state, or the more famous term nanny state. And typically in this debate there was also a use of a comparison between Europe and the US. typically pointing to the UK or the Nordic countries. So welfare reforms in these countries were often labeled as socialist experiments, and not only were they socialist experiments, it was also experiments financed by American taxpayers through the Marshall Plan. And when Arnold Bevan, the father of the British National Health System, in 1950 traveled on a tour in the US and frankly in the newspapers declared that the US is also a welfare state, this created a huge outcry in the American public. So naturally this conceptual arm wrestle also included voices advocating social reforms. But this was not the dominant voice, this was the marginalized voice. So just to give you some examples, so in 1951, when the national state was picked as the topic for a national essay competition, American high school students were asked to answer the topic, resolved that the American people should reject the welfare state. American publishers saw this as a market opportunity, publishing a lot of handbooks for the students, so offering them arguments, typically in the form of quotes. And if you look through these books, also this kind of negative bias becomes pretty clear. I actually tried to see if I could locate some of the essays, which would be quite interesting, but have not succeeded so far. So this strong negative bias is also the conclusion in a report on the concept welfare state to the Library of Congress, published in 1950, where the author, Asher Arkenstein, concluded the more extreme opponents of the welfare state describe it as socialism, and the more moderate refer to it as the halfway house to socialism. And furthermore, in the electoral and in a political campaign in 1950, President Truman openly warned that the welfare state has become what is called a scare concept and should not be used in the political campaign for his idea for social reforms, the so-called fair deal. So, but all this together, of course, you say it's a strong negative term, maybe not so surprising in the US with the widespread welfare skepticism. But what happens if we then travel to Denmark in the same period? So Denmark is, of course, an interesting case in several ways. Firstly, because Denmark, together with other Nordic countries, are typically branded or considered model countries with highly developed welfare states. Secondly, it's interesting because of the close relationship between social democracy and the Nordic welfare states. So sometimes they're labeled as the social democratic model. And there's a general agreement in research that welfare state issue, there's been a social democratic ownership of the welfare state issue in the Scandinavian cases. Thirdly, it's also interesting because Denmark is also often portrayed as a country where there's a very high level of welfare state consensus across parties and interest groups. I mean, all three aspects is of course empirically debatable and can be criticized, but these are strong images in the international debate and also in the party and political debates. So I will not offer a detailed account of the Danish case. Time will not allow for that. But I'll make three interesting, or at least I think they're interesting, observations. So the first observation is that the welfare state, or the concept welfare state, entered Danish political vocabulary only in the 1950s, as part of an intense debate following the suggestions to introduce pension reform, introducing the people's pension in the which was discussed throughout the 1950s. It was used on very few occasions before that, and the use was also in the 1950s in many ways quite negative. So in some ways we could argue that in the Danish, this is a Danish version of the American case. So we find the negative images, we find it in the center-right, politicians fearing that the growing state for economic reasons, is rising taxes, it will make the damage to economic growth, and you also find more ideological debates saying that welfare state collectivism is a sort of threat to freedom. I mean, quite similar to the American case. If you look at the parties or positions left of social democracy, we also find a pretty harsh criticism. So where commentators typically talk about the so-called welfare state, dismissing it as either a capitalist lie or as an integrated part of capitalist exploitation. On top of this, also the church people or religious actors were quite, actively attacking the concept welfare state, typically arguing that this was developing into a kind of a state religion, threatening Lutheranism, as you would say, the ethical point of reference in Danish society. So we have a quote here. It calls itself the welfare state, but there's good reason to ask if the modern state is not becoming a threat to human welfare, if in its belief in itself, it is not placing itself on God's throne. So this is, of course, also a reference to debates about totalitarianism and so on, say, during the early Cold War. The term was defended, to some degree defended, by social democrats and social liberals, typically using it in the 1950s as a vision of the future. One of the most lyrical examples is when the social democratic MP Lene Peter Petersen in 1961 defined the welfare state as the care of the family on a societal scale. However, I mean, altogether, we say that the social democratic use of the concept welfare state in this period was surprisingly limited, which might be explained by Ivo Kampmann, the later Danish prime minister in 1959, declaring that the welfare state has become a scapegoat in line with ministers of finance and other unpopular terms. He knew that pretty well. My second observation is the changing temporality of the welfare state in Denmark in the 1960s and 70s. As I already mentioned, in the 1950s, welfare state was a concept used to define, describe, discuss the future. So when the conservatives in 1956, in the autumn of 1956, had lost the battle over the new pension scheme in Denmark, the Danish people's pension, Paul Møller, one of the leading conservative politicians, declared that now, I quote, now the welfare state will come and we cannot avoid it. And also for the advocates, it was clearly future-oriented. So Jens Otto Krag, the social democratic prime minister, declared, described the welfare state as the leading star for Danish social democracy. But in the 1960s and 70s, this clearly changes in the way that the term was used more to describe the present. So in a way, you could argue that we are now in a welfare state. So it's not about the future, it's about the present situation. And as a result of this, the concept as a tool for political mobilization ran out of steam and tends to become more descriptive in the way it's used. This is also illustrated by the fact that social democracy had to look for new concepts to mobilize. So typically in this period was equality, which became the mobilizing, one of the mobilizing concepts. This only changed in the after the crisis of the welfare state, as in the Danish case following 1973, where social democrats could find a new position as defenders of the welfare state from these kind of outside crises. But this was also like a very much a description of the present, so we are defending status quo in many ways. The third observation on the Danish case is the development from welfare state to welfare society in the most recent decades. So you could ask, maybe all Danish politicians started to read Habermas at the same time, or maybe something else happens. I guess the latter would be more convincing argument. And I think a good illustration of what was going on is the later Liberal Prime Minister from 2001 to 2011, Anders Fogh Rasmussen, and his political rhetoric. So studying this, his rhetoric, it's quite easy to see that for him, the welfare state was referring to something old, the past, whereas the welfare society was the positive vision of the future. So basically, his argument, we need to develop the welfare state into becoming a welfare society. And I think this was use of concepts was not by chance or just a random selection of words. Anders Fogh Rasmussen knew very well what he was doing. I mean, the man known for never blinking when he was on camera knew very well what he said and what words to use. And I think you could also make the argument that the modernization of Venstre, the Danish Liberal Agrarian Party, in the 1990s is actually building exactly on this differentiation, because it allows the Liberal Party to kind of compete or challenge successfully the social democratic ownership of the concept welfare state. So in that way, it also opens a kind of a political opportunity structure for the Liberal Party. And just a short note on this, because I'm going to Finland just after this lecture for a conference, and actually to discuss some of this, because it turned into some kind of, you say, also more bizarre examples, because it triggered a debate also within social democracy in the Nordic countries. And especially the Swedish social democrats in 2013 and 14 launched a campaign to kind of reconquer this kind of lost territory. So what they did was that they claimed the ownership of the term the Nordic model, that included even taking it to registering it as a trademark in Sweden. So you have to be careful if you use the Nordic model in the Swedish context. So it also shows, of course, that this semantic struggle over the welfare state and related terms seems to be going on and on and on. But let's see what's time doing. Let's move to Burma quickly. So to something very completely different. So in Burma, in the 1940s and 50s, I mean, the first question, of course, why on earth Burma? It's based on the simple observation that the first use of the concept welfare state in British Parliament was in 1947, when they discussed the new constitution of Burma, the independent constitution. And one big challenge, of course, studying Burma is that I don't command the Burmese language. There's a lot of available material in English, from cosmic top secret CIA reports to more academic writings about the situation in Burma in the early Cold War. And this material tells a quite interesting history about how social reforms became part of the struggle between, on the one side, the US, UK, and the socialist, but very clearly non-communist Burmese government, and on the other hand, Burmese rebel troops in the north of Burma, supported by China. This was a struggle that basically haunted and defined Burmese politics in the 1940s and 50s. It was also in this context that the idea of social reform as an anti-revolutionary strategy, I mean, in a similar way as Napoleon III or Bismarck in the 19th century, the World Welfare State came into use. It was meant to, you say, attract the attention of workers and farmers, and attract away from, you say, the communist promises, and develop an alternative, positive vision of the future. So the key document in this respect was the Puitauta, I'm sorry if somebody speaks Burmese for my pronunciation, plan from 1952. It's also, this is a stamp from 1953, I mean, marketing this kind of, these political reform ideas. There's a lot of propaganda around it. And you can say, so far so good, this tells a very well-known story about the use of social policy and welfare state as a revolution insurance. But the problem is, it does not really align with what we know about the Burmese case in this period, especially about the strong Burmese nationalism and the strong anti-colonial sentiments in Burma. So as a new independent state, Burma, in the same way as we know from Nehru and India becoming independent a couple of years later, was an outspoken critic of all outside interference in Burmese politics. So all influence from outside powers, being it the US, the UK, or China, tried to keep that out. And I read numerous reports from CIA, from diplomatic observers from the West during these years, and this is underlined again and again and again. So I became puzzled, why do they then import the Western concept of the welfare state? That puzzled me until I stumbled over a somewhat marginal article about Burmese political language. In this article, Tapan Pipan, a US scholar with the Burmese background, he digs into the actual meanings of the word poetauta, which is in the literature always translated as welfare state. But what it points out that in the Burmese context, this has a much more complex meaning, referring and combining different strands of thought. So on the one hand, it includes references to the nation, to Burmese independence. It includes references to the royal tradition, say the glorious history of Burma. And at the same time, it points to the importance of well-being and welfare, so offering promises for the future. And my argument then is that Burmese politicians, mainly the dominant Socialist Alliance Party, in the early 1950s used the term welfare state or poetauta as a way at the same time to signal different things. So it signaled a promising future, so the development of social security and material welfare. It also allowed them to balance between US capitalism and communism, so feeding into the socialist and non-alignment strategy of the country. And it feeded into Burmese nationalism or the anti-colonial sentiments so strongly in Burma through using this kind of specific Burmese version of the welfare state. So, I would say also in this way, concepts are strategic weapons that can be used in struggles, but can also open opportunity structures. And I think, I mean, I could basically make a quite similar argument for the Nordic countries with the use of the welfare state, that it also created a specific opportunity structure for political actors, but I will leave that aside. Just, I mean, one of the points of bringing in the Burmese case is, of course, that this points to, we say, another pitfall, or maybe we say rather a new puzzle that could be included with respect to the importance of translations. So it means I will have to look into the translation also for other countries, how it's translated, why they choose this specific translation as part of it, because that might also actually tell some of the story. So, summing up, I think time is running. So from Germany, with a swift trip to the UK, to the US and Denmark, and ending up in Burma, I could have added several other cases as well. But what does this tell us? What can we learn, besides the nerdy facts, from this global career of the concept of welfare state? I think on a general level, it opens up for new empirical insights in the history of the welfare state. It shows that concept and semantics matters in political struggles. I mentioned Truman's reluctant referring to the welfare state as a scare word. I mean, you could also have mentioned an example from 1952 when the German Social Democrats sent out a memo to all party officials claiming that you should no longer use the term Wohlfahrtsstaat because it gives like the wrong, a little bit of woke skepticism. You should rather use the German word Sozialstaat. So, I mean, the contemporary actors and observers were very well aware of this fact as well. So, my argument is that language have to be taken into account when writing the political history of the welfare state. Second, I also think that these kind of studies might help qualify, say, the more theoretical considerations on the role of concepts. I think in this field there's still quite a lot of work to do, and I'm right now, together with some colleagues, trying to plan some different types of studies potentially addressing this kind of stuff. So one interesting thing could be, for instance, quite simple framing experiments. Does framing a topic as welfare state or welfare society matter for people's attitude? Or you could look at other concepts like social security, Sozialstaat, and so on. And what does, I mean, does this affect people's attitude towards state intervention, for instance? I mean, across countries, difference, but also difference within countries. Based on these experience, we might also be able to develop a more quite interesting discussion about the emotional character of key concepts, or simply why are some concepts very sticky and other concepts disappear after a short while. These are, of course, pretty complex questions, but I think the emotional character or quality of a concept might be part of the explanation. And then finally, on a more kind of overarching theoretical level, I think the idea of linking this kind of semantic conceptual approach with the historical institutionalism might also be quite interesting. So we have a lot of theories about language, conceptual history, semantic framing, and so on. But I think we really lack people trying to link language power and institutions. And I think this would be in order to make it more part of mainstream, let's say, welfare state history, this would be a next step. Then finally, as a third thing, so even though my exposé of the history of the welfare state does not lead to any standard definition of welfare state in the Weberian sense, I think at least it maps the terrain and thereby also offers a way out of the challenge of comparative analysis over time across country, as it has been presented by the British sociologist and historian Noel Whiteside in 2005, where she argues that comparative analysis is plagued by problems of similar policies disguised by different terminology and different policies, agencies and instruments that have almost similar labels. So words get in our way. So absolutely words get in our way, but I actually don't think it's a bad thing. I think it's also something that allows us to ask new and interesting questions. So I suggest we do that. Thank you.
Thank you, Klaus, for this excellent lecture, and we still have time for questions and comments to what you told us. Yes, please.
Yeah. Okay. Just a question. So I suppose that this concept of welfare state has some consequences in terms of, say, legislation. So what has changed historically from the time of Bismarck to the time of to our times? Because I'm sure that it's not the same welfare state we're talking about. Could you briefly sketch what has happened?
Well, I don't know about briefly.
Okay.
So basically, this was the topic of our 7-volume Danish welfare state history.
Okay.
So, and of course, it's been like a tremendous change in welfare states. So, I mean, you have to remember in that way that history is an open-ended process. And if you look at, look at the debates, say, around the 19th century, or the 1900s, or even in the following decades, no political, even the most firm advocate for social reforms could imagine the type of welfare state we have today. I mean, the scale of it, the level of taxation. I mean, so basically, there's been enormous change, especially in this period from 1945 and onwards. I mean, it's typically labeled the golden age of the welfare state. That's where you have the real expansions in terms of social spending, number of institutions and programs and benefit levels and so on. So it's clear, I mean, they're not discussing the actual same political reality. And that might also explain some of this temporality. So you have the enormous growth of the welfare state in 1960s, which of course also means a lot of people get some kind of attachment to the welfare state. I mean, you get your salary from it, you get your benefits from it, you get your whatever from it.
Other questions or comments, please? Yeah, please.
Thank you, Klaus. I was very much intrigued by the long-term perspective of the analysis. I think the main message that I take away from the talk is that the relationship between the vocabulary that we use and the reality that it's supposed to reflect is a very complex one. Mm. It's not a straightforward relationship, and that's something I think is important, like to problematize it, because it's something that in a lot of social science research is overlooked. I mean, it's not really, we don't really pay much attention to this in political science in particular. I was wondering if you had considered maybe to extend your analysis to include other related concepts, mm-hmm. for instance, like concepts like social market economy in Germany, which has also changed quite a lot. I mean, the meaning of the term social market economy has changed a lot. It was initially in the 1950s coined by neoliberals and market liberals, who saw the social market economy as an alternative to communism or socialism, basically, so the lesser evil. And now over time, it has become kind of like a world synonym for the world as bad.
Yeah, yeah.
So I think this is quite interesting, like to look at how such concepts evolve in terms of their political meaning over time, and how it's used by different political actors.
Yeah, yeah.
And it also relates to this question of how concepts are used politically. So also with relation to the welfare state. I mean, what is the welfare state presented as an alternative to? Is the welfare state the alternative to the communism, or is it? Is the welfare state the alternative to capitalism, or is it something that we should defend, or something that we should avoid? And I think this, like, how concepts are used politically over time, this changes quite a lot. Seems to me.
There's a lot of questions. No, I mean, I totally agree. I think what political scientists sometimes also miss is the relationship. So, I mean, it's not only that the concept describes something that is changing and so on, but also that concepts can actually change the reality in a way. So it could become also part of the explanation why things develop in the way they do. So they also have like a political, element in that way. But I think the other question is, of course, I mean, basically you are asking me to address this in a totally different way, to look at what kind of concepts and semantics are used to describe, you say, the social policy scene or whatever we call it in different countries. And we tried to do this in this book, so I could do a little bit of advertising. I co-edited with Danielle in 2014. And that, of course, shows there's a lot of national tradition. So you have, I mean, go to France, you have different different concepts, l'état providence or Sécurité sociale. You have to go to the US, you also have social security as different concepts, Sozialstaat or Soziale Marktwirtschaft in Germany and so on and so forth. So there's a lot of traditions where different concepts are used to it. So I think, I mean, the only way I can do this is by like fixing on one concept. It does, of course, not mean that I don't relate to the other concepts as well, but I cannot offer do the same more systematic. So what I use is kind of other concept is to relativize, a bit to argue the importance of the concept in different contexts rather, because only it simply becomes too much work.
In terms of research,
I'm a very practical.
Yeah. We still have time for one more question, and this comes from Anne-Marie.
Thank you. That was a really nice talk. There's kind of in the analysis. If we look at the Danish case, there's one thing that puzzles me. So, I mean, in the same. So in Denmark, the welfare state in the 50s is not a positive term. It's used and very much criticized by more or less all parties. And still, I mean, it's a really great factor in Danish politics. I mean, so there is that. So how does a concept that has that much adversity, in a sense, become so effective? And you find something similar in literature. We discussed it in the earlier project that, you know, in Danish literature, the welfare state will very often be portrayed very negatively. So we lose meaning and we get trapped in all these. And still, it seems that Danish, in the way we have ordered Danish society, it's been really, that idea has been really influential. So how do you kind of, there seems to be, in a sense, some kind of difference between the way it's been a prügelknabe, and still has been a really effective political
deal. I think it's probably different things. So depending on what type of criticism you address. So you say the center-right criticism is kind of get watered out throughout the 1960s for two reasons. Partly because the center-right party becomes part of this kind of great political broad alliances behind the welfare reforms, but partly also because the economic argument against the welfare state, that it endangers economic development and growth, is hard to really to argue in the 1960s because you have the highest growth rate in the 20th century. But it comes back, I mean, if you look at the debate from the 17th and 80s for the central right. With the left, it's like you have like a total turnaround, a U-turn in the way the center left. So there are pretty criticism, I mean, as they also do the literature, it's the same type of criticism we find. But if you look at the debate from the 1970s and onwards, they gradually become the most firm defenders of the welfare status quo. I think it's related to, I mean, what is happening ideologically with the Soviet Union or this kind of development. It's also related to the EU. Suddenly you need an alternative to Europe. And the center leftists, I mean, this is one of the most salient political topics for them. So I think that's part of the package. And also, suddenly the international crisis from the mid-1970s, I mean, brings people closer to the defense lines of the welfare state in general. That would be elements in an explanation.
But still, I was just in this period from the 1950s to 1970, which you were focusing on, where people seem to be very critical, and still that's maybe the main development of.
Yeah, we could say, I mean, you have the paradox in the US, they successfully used this kind of, I mean, conquering the concept and may turn into something pretty. In the Danish case, this also happened, the concept, but they were not successful when it comes to the actual policies. That would be my difference. I mean, the welfare state was like rolling anyway, partly also maybe reflecting the majority of welfare states before the debates took off.
Well, this brings us to a conclusion, and thank you very much for coming and giving us.